الحمد لله الحمد لله نحمده ونشكره ونستعين به جل وعلا ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ به سبحانه وتعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فهو المهتد، ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. عباد الله، أنصحكم ونفسي الآثمة بتقوى الله، وأحثكم وإياها على طاعته، وأحذركم وإياها وبال مخالفته جل وعلا ومعصيته. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ولا شيء مثله، ولا شيء قبله، ولا شيء معه، ولا شيء يعجزه. قديم بلا ابتداء، دائم بلا انتهاء، لا يفنى ولا يبيد، ولا يكون إلا ما يريد. لا تبلغه الأوهام، ولا تدركه الأفهام، ولا يشبه الأنام. حي لا يموت، قيوم لا ينام. وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا وعظيمنا وشفيعنا ونبينا وقرة أعيننا ونور أبصارنا وبصائرنا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم، عبد الله ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله، أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله ولو كره الكافرون. صل اللهم وسلم وبارك وجدد وضاعف وعظم ومجد على هذا النبي الأمين وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين، وارض اللهم عن صحابة رسول الله المخلصين المحسنين المتقين، ولا سيما السابقون الأولون، بدءا بالخلفاء الراشدين سيدنا أبي بكر الصديق، وسيدنا عمر بن الخطاب، وسيدنا عثمان بن عفان، وسيدنا علي بن أبي طالب، وعن سائر الصحابة والتابعين ومن اتبعهم بإحسان وتمسك بالثقلين إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، عباد الله، يقول الله جل وعلا في سورة القصص بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: طاسيم ميم، تلك آيات الكتاب المبين. نتلو عليك من نبأ موسى وفرعون بالحق لقوم يؤمنون. الآيات من سورة القصص. And سورة القصص it starts with موسى عليه السلام and فرعون. And I said before many times, and many of you of course know already, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not tell us stories. Al-Quran is not a storybook, nor is it a fairy tale book. These events that happen in the Quran happen, and Allah wants us to learn from these things for one reason, actually for many reasons, but one of them is that history always repeats itself. And humans are humans, whether they lived 1,000 years ago, 2,000 years ago, 6,000 years ago, or they live now. There are certain things, certain characteristics of human nature that still exist in humans. But furthermore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to learn about the struggle in the dunya. And I always mention this, and you might get sick of me talking about it, but I always say it again. Life is a struggle between good and evil. Life is a struggle between right and wrong. Life is a struggle between haqq and batil. Life is a struggle between freedom and slavery. Always. Life is a struggle between al-zulumat wa al-nur. La tastawi al-zulumat wa al-nur. There will always be Musa, and there will always be Fir'aun. There will always be Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I'm not saying that the same, but people will take their roles, and people will take their message, and people will take their mission, and there will always be Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab, etc., etc. Allah tells us about موسى and Fir'aun. What is موسى? Who is موسى عليه السلام? نبي الله, نبي مرسل. موسى عليه السلام, his name is موسى بن عمران. موسى بن عمران. Three generation, he is the son of يعقوب. He goes to يعقوب, to إسحاق عليه السلام, son of إبراهيم عليه السلام. موسى بن عمران, of course, is, you see the Quran, maybe you could comfortably say that almost one quarter or maybe up to one third of the Quran is talking somehow about Musa and what Musa alayhi salam did and how people dealt with Musa alayhi salam. It seems like they will deal with people like that, or we will deal with people like that all the time. Musa was born in a, of course, in that time it used to be called Egypt, the entire area, including that desert now. They used to call that Egypt. Basically, Fir'aun is a title. It's not a name. Okay? There's no such person named Fir'aun. But it's a title. Like the kings of Egypt, they used to be called Fir'aun, pharaohs. Like the kings of Persia, they used to call them Khosrow or Kisra. And other kings, they used to call them Shah. And the kings of Romans, they used to call them Kaiser. So Kaiser was not only one Kaiser, many Kaisers. So Fir'aun was the name. Many of the Mufassireen, they go on to say the name of that Fir'aun was Al-Walid bin Mus'ab or others. Allah knows best. Anyway, that one, that person who ruled Egypt at that time, and let me take you back in history for a few thousand years, if you allow me, to that time where Musa alayhi salam was. Fir'aun was not this kind of, this Fir'aun that came, because there's always Fir'auns, but this Fir'aun that came was not like any other Fir'aun. He was much more tyrant and much more thick of a dictator than any other Fir'aun king. He went to the extent to say, وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَىٰ. I am your supreme lord. And then he first went to say also, يَا قَوْمِ مَا عَلِمْتُ لَكُمْ مِنْ إِلَٰهٍ غَيْرِي. The Quran says, on his behalf, he told his people, all people, my people, I don't know any other god for you than me. So the people at the time of Fir'aun, they wouldn't call him Fir'aun. If you called him Fir'aun, they would kill you. What you're supposed to call him? God. That's how it is. Yeah, people will go on in their tyranny, until they say, like Fir'aun, he looked on earth. Fir'aun looked everywhere, the king, the kingdoms, the countries on earth at that time. He said, يَا قَوْمْ مَا عَلِمْتُ لَكُمْ مِنْ إِلَهٍ غَيْرِي. Oh people, there's no other God but me on this earth. That's it. Supreme power. Like, remember the German philosopher Nietzsche, who said, might makes right. That's the old thinking. Okay. So Fir'aun said, man, there's no God but me here. And it's funny how people always followed without questioning. SubhanAllah. How people always attracted to power, regardless whether it's right or wrong. Right, wrong, they still follow. There's no stand. An example, I'll say this and we'll continue inshallah with our bahth. One day, Mughals and the Tatar from Northeast Asia, they invaded Iraq and Syria, Bilad al-Sham and all this area, if you all remember in history. Basically, they invaded before they were Muslims. They became Muslims afterwards, alhamdulillah. But before that, they invaded Iraq and they invaded Syria and all that area. And the history says that they threw all the books, the treasure of books. The library of Baghdad at that time used to be the central library of the world, where every kind of knowledge is seeked right there. If you want to learn anything, you want to learn chemistry, you go to Jabr ibn Hayyan in Kufi. In Kuf, you want to learn, that's where you go. Chemistry, physics, even medicine, Razi, all these people, you go to these books over there in Baghdad. Of course, when the Mughals came and the Tatar came, they took all these books because their people at that time, they didn't know anything but the sword. They haven't appreciated the civilization that the Muslim nation has reached at that time. They took all these books and they dumped it in the Tigris River or Dijla, the river, or Al-Furat also, until people said that the color of the water of that river, which is a huge river back then, especially not like now, it had turned blue from the ink. Because in the old days they didn't used to print, they used to write. Imagine. And then they continued these waves of armies, huge armies, and the old leaders they burned and they killed, ruthless to the furthest extent. They came to Syria, and also there was fighting in all this. Anyway, I think in year 669, if I'm not mistaken, there was the final battle, and the Muslims won. And many of these Mughals and Tatar became Muslims. Among their kings or leaders, a man named Taymurlan. Taymurlan is known, if you go to history, you say Taymurlan, right? Taymurlan, one time he was in Damascus, he said, he gathered some scholars, he said, I'm really a tyrant. He was a tyrant. Tagia, he did things, very unjust things. So he gathered the people around him. He said, I'm very fond of the names. I'm now the chief. I'm very fond of the titles that the Abbasi Khalifas or Abbasi rulers used to call themselves. Al-Mutawakkil ala Allah, Al-Waqif Billah. Remember that the Abbasi rulers, just like everybody else, after the Khulafa Rashidin, everybody else, they make their own kingdom and their own empire. But anyway, the Abbasi rulers, they used to call themselves titles with at the end with Allah, like Al-Mutawakkil ala Allah, that he is depending on Allah. Meaning, meanwhile, he killed most of the Muslims at that time. Any scholar said anything true, he killed them. Okay. Al-Wathiq Billah, he is trustworthy and he's trusting Allah. Al-Mudhaffar Billah, he is victorious by Allah. Al-Muntasar Billah. So he's telling this scholar, his name is Nasruddin. He said, Nasruddin, I am very fond of these titles that the Abbasi rulers used to call themselves Al-Wathiq Billah, Al-Muntasar Billah, Al-Mustansar Billah. Can you find me a name also like this so I can call myself with? This sheikh, this scholar, he was wise. He looked at him, he said, yes, Na'udhu Billah. Because also ends with Allah. Of course, some scholars used to do that with some kind of, depending on the situation. And of course, he said this, and then what is he going to do? Taymurlan, he looked at him, he said, go. Because everybody around him laughed at him. What Mustansar, what Mustansar, what Mudaffar, what did you do for Islam? Okay. So people follow. You tell them whatever it is, to follow. And we forgot what Quran and Sunnah gave us. The Quran of Allah Jalla wa'ala and the authentic Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam came to tell us what? Always verify. Always verify. If someone comes and tells you such and such person said this, don't take stand because otherwise you'll be fasiq, you will sin. Go and ask that person yourself, not second-hand information. Al-Quran and the Sunnah always emphasized on first-hand info, not second-hand info. Let's move on. Because the propaganda of Fir'aun, they told people he is the Lord. He says he's the Lord, so everybody says he's Lord. Fir'aun one day, he saw a dream. Imam Tabari, rahimahullah, in his tafsir, Imam Tabari, Shaykh al-Mufassirin, radiyallahu anhu wa rahimah. He says, Fir'aun one day saw a dream. What's that dream? And the dream, dreams are always a contact of the soul with other things. This is something to prove also that the human being is not simply a body. The human being is also a soul. There's a spirit that goes and comes. You sit right here in Atlanta and your soul dreams you're right in Mecca. What happened? All these barriers, all these physical barriers, all this distance, nothing. It's like nothing. And this is exactly the point. Because the body is out of material and out of mass. It's limited by the laws of physics. while the spirit is from a different nature, which is not limited by the laws of physics, which means distance and time, etc., etc., etc. But again, that's not our topic today. Though one man came to Ibn Sirin, radiallahu anhu, tabi'i jaleel, is a tabi'i. And Ibn Sirin, rahimahullah ta'ala, used to be the, almost at this, of his time, the master scholar who interprets dreams. Anyone who has a dream, he goes to Ibn Sirin. And Ibn Sirin used to give him, and it comes always, almost always, like, as true. One time, a man came to Ibn Sirin, and he knocked the door. His servant opened up the door. And the man asked her, where is Ibn Sirin? She told him, he's asleep upstairs. He said, let me in. She said, no, don't bother him. When he wakes up, you can come back. He said, no, I want to go in right now. She said, what do you want? Tell me, I can tell you. You know, because if you stay with people for a long time, you kind of, it rubs off. You kind of learn from them. And therefore, you're supposed to stay with scholars for a long time, so you maybe learn from them. And if you stay with ignorance a long time, you also learn from them. But always, al-kareem bil yuqara biman ibtaran. As-sahib sahib. Okay. So Ibn Sirin told her, he said, well, I saw in my dream that I will fall and die. She said, okay, then you're going to fall and die. Said, stay out, get out of my face. He went up to see Ibn Sirin. On the stairs, he fell and died. Because many times, they say a dream is like a bird. Whenever you cut it, whenever you tell people about it, it'll fall, it'll happen. مَتَا قُصَّ وَقَى. Therefore, from the Sunnah, if you have a bad dream, that you don't tell anyone about it. You wake up and you say, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. You spit 3 times on your left side, and don't tell anyone about it.
Go and say, you know, I saw this one.
But if you see a good dream, scholars say 2 things. You may tell only if you're afraid of, let's say, people may envy you or something, then you don't tell. But then you tell people who you like, who you trust, and who are good people. Huh? And of course, if it's a good dream, then you only, a very good dream, like a piety dream or piousness, then you only tell people who you're sure they won't think bad about you, that you're trying to magnify or magnify yourself. Anyway, Fir'aun saw a dream. What's that dream? He said, he woke up very, very upset. He called these dream interpreters and magicians and all these people around him, the Munajjimeen. He told them, I'm very upset. What happened? He said, I saw a bad dream. What did you see? Oh Lord, they called him. He said, I saw like fire came from Bayt al-Maqdis. Fire came from the direction of Jerusalem. And it came all the way around my kingdom. And it started burning everything. And it only left the houses of Bani Israel. Because in Egypt at that time, there were 2 people. They were Al-Aqbat Coptics.
The Coptics still there until today.
And they were Bani Israel. So those who followed Yani, those who followed Ishaq wa Yaqub, alayhim salam. So he said, I saw this fire coming and burning all these houses and burning everything and leaving the houses of Bani Israel untouched. What is going on here? The Imam Tabari says, these interpreters, they told him, we have bad news for you. What's the bad news? He said, they told him the bad news is that according to what we can tell, there will be this year or the next few years, there will be a person who will be born from Bani Israel who will change your kingdom, change the deen of your people. What's the deen of his people? Worshipping him. He will change this deen, he will change the kingdom, and he will destroy what you have built. The one who's going to be born soon, few years. Fir'aun made a Faraman. Faraman means he ordered an order, a royal order, a decree.
That's what it means.
This decree, what does this decree, Fir'aun's Faraman decree? Fir'aun's Faraman decreed that anyone who is born from Bani Israel must be slaughtered. Every single one. And he went and went to those nurses, those who are, they were not, they were probably at that time not obstetricians, but there were nurses who were in charge of delivering babies. He told them, every time you give birth to a male baby or male infant from Bani Israel, you must alert my forces and they must kill him. If you don't alert the forces, we will kill you. Terror at its height. Born, you die. Why? No reason. Quran felt like that. And then years and years and years, and Mufassirin says, tens of years passed by, and Fir'aun is killing almost every single male that is born to Bani Israel, until even the older ones, the older males of Bani Israel that have that survived somehow, they were dying. And there were only left, what is left? There was left only the females. Fir'aun used to do with the females what? He used to use the females for his maids in his palaces. To serve, kill, يذبحون أبناءكم ويستحيون نساءكم. They slaughter your male children and they will enslave your female children. And this is the sunnah of everybody that does that. That's not only Fir'aun, comes in many different shapes. Okay. So then Fir'aun, these Coptic Christians. The chiefs of Coptic Christians, Akbar, they went to Fir'aun, they said, you are putting us in a bad problem. He said, why? They said, number one, there is no more males, young people among the Bani Israel. And if you keep killing all their males, and their older males are dying, then we're going to end up serving. Because there's nobody left. But then they don't want to serve, because they were the higher class. So, Fir'aun said, okay, we'll do 1 year, we'll kill all the infants, all the male infants, and the other year, we won't kill all the infants. 1 year like this, 1 year like that. So, therefore, Musa alayhi salam was born in a year where all the infants must die. While Harun alayhi salam was born in a year where infants could have lived, supposedly. Allah is the one that gives life and death anyway. Anyway, the Quran Kareem goes through these steps. نَتْلُوا عَلَيْكَ مِنْ نَبَئِ مُوسَى وَفِرْعَوْنَ بِالْحَقِّ لِقَوْمٍ يُؤْمِنُونَ This is the events that happened to Fir'aun, Musa wa Fir'aun, for those who believe. So you can understand from it. إِنَّ فِرْعَوْنَ عَلَى فِي الْأَرْضِ Fir'aun, عَلَى فِي الْأَرْضِ What does ala mean? Ala really means elevated. Yani was up, was high. What does that mean? That doesn't mean literally. He was not up literally, but it means he was a tyrant. He was a transgressor. Baga fil ard. Ala fil ard, ay baga fil ard. Yastab'ifu ahlaha. He takes the people, huh? And what does he do with the Fir'aun, with the people? He divides them. Makes them shi'an. Ja'alahum shi'an. What does that mean, Shia? Shia means, comes from Shia. Shia means firqa. Firqa means sect or group of people. In the Arabic language, linguistically, Shia means sect or group of people, regardless what they are. Now we say Shia for those who believe in 12 Imams or others. But linguistically speaking, Shia really means a group of people. What Fir'aun's strategy was, how can I conquer these people? How can I enslave these people? Number one, I have to divide them and make them Shia, make them groups, subgroups. This group hates the other group, and the other group fights the other group. And remember, divide and conquer? People thought always it was by the British Empire. Think again, it was by Fir'aun. Fir'aun made this, actually started this, initiated this, and he made people different sects and different Shia. And so you can divide, this way you can conquer them. يذبح أبناءهم ويستحيي نساءهم إنه كان من المفسدين. Allah says, Fir'aun was mufsid. Mufsid destroyer. He, he makes bad things. And Allah says then, وَنُرِيدُ أَن نَمُنَّ عَلَى الَّذِينَ اسْتُضْعِفُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَنَجْعَلَهُمْ أَئِمَّةً وَنَجْعَلَهُمُ الْوَارِثِينَ. But this is what Fir'aun wants. Fir'aun wants to destroy, and he wants to divide and conquer. But Allah says, وَنُرِيدُ, but we will, نُرِيدُ أَن نَمُنَّ عَلَى الَّذِينَ اسْتُضْعِفُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ. We will give bounties to those who have been weakened in this earth, those who have been enslaved on this earth, those who have been suppressed on this earth, those who have been oppressed on this earth, and we will make them the inheritance of this earth. وَنُرِيدُ أَن نَمُنَّ عَلَى الَّذِينَ اسْتُضْعِفُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَنَجْعَلَهُمْ أَئِمَّةً. We'll make them the leaders. إِمَام is a leader. وَنَجْعَلَهُمُ الْوَارِثِينَ. And we will make them also الْوَارِثِينَ, inheritance. وَنُمَكِّنَ لَهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Not only that, we will make them secure on earth. وَنُمَكِّنَ لَهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَنُرِيَ فِرْعَوْنَ وَهَامَانَ وَجُنُودَهُمَا مِنْهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يَحْذَرُونَ. And we will secure them, and then Fir'aun and Haman and their soldiers will see from them what they have always cautioned themselves from. What happened? The mother of Musa رضي الله عنها أو عليه السلام was pregnant. In the year that Fir'aun decreed any born baby must die, what does she do? She got upset, she got scared, she got saddened. The soldiers of Fir'aun going all over the place, and anyone they see pregnant, not only that, they wait for her to deliver. If they see her pregnant, it went to a time where if they saw any person pregnant in that year, they just killed her anyway. Let me add to that.
That reminds you of what happened in 1947. Dere Yassin and all these things.
Okay. The mother of Musa, what does she do? From the karama of Allah, Allah blessed her with something that her stomach or her belly did not ever show that she was pregnant. She was pregnant, but it never showed to the people. So people didn't know that she was pregnant. She knew, of course, but everybody else didn't know. So they couldn't tell on her, because people at that time used to tell. Time for delivery came. More worried, the mother of Musa alayhi salam. Very worried, what do I do? She delivered without asking any help. One by herself. Her husband had died before. She is left by herself. She had, of course, another daughter. And she had the help of her daughter, and she delivered. Nobody to help her. Allah, of course, is helping her. And then, here she delivered. What does she do now? The baby cries. People hear. It's not like nowadays. People hear. They say there's a born baby. What does she do? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَأُحَيْنَا إِلَىٰ أُمِّ مُوسَىٰ أَنَ رْضِعِينَ. We told Umm Musa. Allah commanded Umm Musa, the mother of Musa, directly. Told her, of course in her heart, told her, breastfeed him and don't worry. Breastfeed him and رْضِعِينَ. فَإِذَا خِفْتِ عَلَيْهِ. If you got scared and you worried about him, فَأَلْقِيهِ فِي الْيَمْ. Then throw him in the river. What do you mean throw him in the river?
Mother, you're telling a mother throw him in the river?
She was commanded to go and make a box, tabut, coffin, but a small one. She went to a carpenter at that time. She told him, I want you to make me a small coffin. She was worried that she throws him like this, she dies. She's the mother, remember. He said, what do you want that for? She said, don't worry about that, but don't make any holes on it from the bottom.
Like that, only if you want to make holes from top.
The carpenter, like everybody else in the third world countries, they are always working with the intelligence of that, usually, right? Or like every second person is working with somebody.
He was worried. He said, she came to me,
I'm suspectful, I'm suspicious. What is she doing? So, Najjar, he made what, the carpenter made what she wanted, gave it to her. This is how much coffee she bought it. And he went to Fir'aun, to the palace. And he told the guard, he said, I'm sorry, I want to meet the Lord.
Who are you? You're some carpenter.
He says, I have very important information. I can only tell the Lord. What does he want to tell her? He suspected that maybe she has a kid and she defied the orders of Fir'aun, the Faraman of Fir'aun, and therefore she should die. Why did she deliver? She should have told. Okay. The letter, he goes in front of Fir'aun and he wants to tell him and his tongue stops. You know when you wake up sometimes in your dream and you want to talk and you can't talk? His tongue's tied. He wants to say, I can't say anything.
Fir'aun told the soldiers, take this man out.
He goes after the soldiers, he talks again. He says, I need to go and talk to him.
They said, we sent you there, you stood in front of the Lord, and he didn't say,
please.
He sends him again. They send him again.
Go. He stands in front of Fir'aun, his tongue gets tied again, can't talk.
They send him, they said, this is the last chance. Go. If I see you again, I'll kill you. Fir'aun tells him, you're mocking the Lord? Go.
They send him back, and then he says it's very important, he tells the guards, very important, I have to get to him, tell him there is this and this. They send him the last time, and he does it, and the same thing, his tongue gets tied, and Fir'aun kills him. Okay. What is the plan for the mother of Musa alayhi salam? The plan for the mother of Musa is that she puts Musa in this coffin or this wooden box and she lays it on the surface of the water. Her house was next to the Nile River.
See the Nile River? Next to it.
So what she did is she put a rope around and she hooked the rope to the box and she hooked it to her house. And anyone, whenever she hears someone coming to her house, she puts the box on in the water, she ties the rope and she lets it float till people go, and then she takes it back and she breastfeeds him.
Subhanallah.
Allah wants to take care of his people.
الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا كما أمر وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده ما اتصلت عين بنظر وسمعت أذن بخبر وأشهد أن سيدنا مولانا وحبيبنا وعظيمنا وسيدنا وشفيعنا وقرة أعيننا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم خاتم الأنبياء المعتبر صل اللهم وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله أهل الفقه والنظر والعلم والأثر وعلى من بآثاره اقتفى واعتبر.
Until one day, when she had somebody came, or she was scared of soldiers passing by, hearing something, she put him in the river in that coffin, and she didn't tie the rope good enough. And some wave or something came that took this box with Musa alayhi salam in it, and took it all the way through the river. Of course, when his mother noticed this, what can she do? You know how mothers are. She started crying. Allah told her, لا تخافي ولا تحزني. Don't worry and don't be scared. إِنَّا رَادُّوهُ إِلَيْهِ وَجَاعِلُوهُ مِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. We will bring him back to you. Not only that, and we will make him a prophet and a messenger. Not only he's coming back to you. No. Leave him. He's gone. Leave him. إِنَّا رَادُّوهُ إِلَيْهِ. We will return him back to you, and we will make him a great messenger. And so was he, sallallahu alayhi wa ala nabiyyina wa alayhi wa sallam. Inshallah, we will continue if Allah gives us time next week. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammad, kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ali Ibrahim. Barak ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammad, kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim. Fil alamin, innaka hamidun majid. Allahumma ansur al-Islam wal-Muslimin, wa a'li ya maulana kalimat al-haq wal-din. Allahumma man arada bil-Islam wal-Muslimin khayran fawfiqhu ilayh, wa man arada bihim ghayra dhalika faj'al da'ira tassawi alayh. Allahumma rudd al-Muslimin ila dinika raddan jameela, aati anfusana taqwaha, zakkiha anta khayru man zakaha, anta waliyuha rabbana wa maulaha. Allahumma arifna bil-Qur'an, Allahumma arifna bil-Sunnah, Allahumma amitna ala
السنة، اللهم أحينا على السنة، اللهم اجمعنا مع أهل السنة، اللهم احشرنا مع أهل السنة، اللهم احشرنا تحت راية السنة، اللهم اجمعنا على حوض صاحب السنة، اللهم اغفر لنا ولآبائنا ولمشايخنا ولمن له حق علينا ولمن على الخير أعاننا ولمن عن الشر أبعدنا ولمن أوصانا بالدعاء، وصلى الله وسلم على محمد وآله. أقيم الصلاة.